Well, I wanted to just talk a little bit this morning about some of Great River Energy's perspectives around energy efficiency and demand side management, especially as it relates to agricultural production, including swine facilities. Great River Energy is a wholesale generation and transmission cooperative. We have our major assets in terms of generation production are located in North Dakota with our Coal Creek Station facility in Underwood. We recently closed down one of our older coal plants in Stanton Station, which ended production at the beginning of March. And what we see going forward is quite a bit of variability in our generation mix. In particular, wind energy is basically the largest generation resource that we're going to be involved in adding and participating in. Our CEO, David Segu, recently said at a function that wind is actually our new baseload because it's driving the market price in terms of energy purchases within the wholesale markets, and really it's what all of our other generation resources are responding to. We've recently initiated an effort to have our largest coal facility, a baseload coal plant, be more flexible and have the ability to ramp down to 300 megawatts, which was previously something that people never thought you could do with a coal plant. You hear this a lot. Baseload facilities are expected to run flat out all the time, and they don't really provide a lot of flexibility in terms of ramping capacity. But we're through our engineering efforts and the work of our engineers, we're having that, we're doing that right now, and we're responding to the market. We serve 28 member cooperatives throughout the state of Minnesota. We have a little bit of service territory in Wisconsin, and we're the second largest facility in Minnesota, serving about 1.7 million people. And clearly, farms and agricultural production is a huge part of what our members are involved in on a day-to-day basis. Just by way of comparison to other utility types, both investor-owned and publicly owned municipal utilities, what characterizes cooperatives is really a lack of density, and we're fairly spread out. Lots of wires, pretty high distribution plant cost per customer. But what this really gives us an opportunity for is adopting new technologies. And some of our member cooperatives have been the first to adopt automated metering infrastructure and are looking at how do you improve intelligence on the grid, especially on the distribution side of the grid. And that's where, especially during storm events, we see some of those some of the payoffs in terms of restoration and our members' ability to restore after significant weather events. A lot of that has to do with some of the investments that have been made in having the visibility into where the system is. You know, it's not too long ago that the way that people knew there was a power outage was that the members or their utility customers called them and told them they didn't have power. That's how you knew. You didn't have any visibility in the system. We're building that in. Our members are working very hard to build that intelligence in the system so they can better pinpoint outages and better respond through the mobilization. When GRE looks at energy efficiency, we look at it through a number of lenses. First, you know, it's a first fuel type of situation. It's much cheaper to build efficiency and buy efficiency from our members and help to buy down the cost of energy efficiency retrofits than it is to build a new energy facility. And that really doesn't matter what kind of energy facility it is much cheaper to buy down the cost of, you know, VFDs and whatnot at a rate of 20% of capital costs through our members than it is to build a new plant. It is a goal, it's a requirement for all utilities to pursue, and it's built into our future resource plans. And ultimately, it helps to kind of establish, you know, an engagement offering between our members and our members' energy consumption, so that we have a better understanding of how our members are using energy, and we can better shape that load. A lot of what we talk about now with variable generation is our ability to shape the load through demand response activities, but also through energy efficiency, is going to be critical in terms of helping to optimize how we are using energy, and especially when we can utilize energy at its lowest cost. Just some of our agricultural program offerings. You know, LED lighting has you know, been a step change over the past several years. It is going gangbusters. Both the market price has come down to a point where it's very market ready, I guess you'd say, and we're seeing adoption rates this year in particular that we've never seen in years past. And this has happened over the course of, you know, a 5-year period, just a tremendous drop in the price of LED lighting technologies, and it's really driving our program achievements. Specific to swine production, hog farrowing controls, which, you know, basically regulate the price or the temperature of hog farrowing lamps, water heating, and agricultural ventilation. And ag ventilation is what you heard Dr. Brum mention. You know, ag ventilation, you know, from a summer impact standpoint is critical to look to for ways to reduce that consumption. We can't necessarily control ag ventilation through demand response activities because of the negative implications there, but if we can look at VFDs and using some of the larger high volume, low speed vent fans to the extent that they're available, we'd like to do that just to lower our total baseload consumption expenses for our members and for our purchases. And then demand response programs for irrigators are one of our bigger, you know, agricultural specific programs for load management. We do have a fair amount of CNI commercial gensets that agricultural producers also use, but those, you know, run into some other challenges with respect to maintenance and new requirements from the EPA and others. As far as, you know, a resource for GRE, we spend through, you know, GRE and our member cooperatives about $20 million annually on energy efficiency programs, and we're seeing that cost kind of go up a little bit as well. And where we get our achievements is really largely lighting on the commercial and industrial side of the equation, lighting. But we do get a lot of achievements through our residential program activities, and that's changing a bit as we see a lot of the residential end uses kind of get transformed into energy efficient products through the advancement of standards and codes. Some of the things that we're looking at now is really electrification opportunities that help to utilize some of the low-cost renewable power that we have in place. Looking at air source and ground source heat pumps, electric vehicles haven't been as big for GRE because they've been concentrated in the metro area, but that's a huge opportunity for us and for our membership. And then on the agricultural side, we've seen some robotic milking systems start to gain market share and traction that we're working to encourage. When we look at, you know, how we are, you know, really trying to manage what is a load curve, and this is what, you know, a typical load curve looks like in the summer months, we see that lowering that overall magnitude through energy efficiency is a longer term strategy versus our ability to really shave that peak off with demand response activities. And so with respect to lowering the overall consumption, we're looking at those energy end uses that have high run hours, lighting, ventilation. Those are prime targets for, you know, lowering that total curve. And then where are those opportunities for controllable load, irrigation, water heating, AC, and gen sets. Those are really the ones that really help us cut that peak curve off. And this is what, you know, the green line represents, kind of a load control period where we initiate a control event and really drop that peak demand to a point where it's much lower than it would otherwise have been. And that helps us manage our system costs and keep our growth down so that we don't have to add additional facilities. And we try to do this all through marketing and branding. Our EnergyWise MN marketing materials really help to highlight the programs that we have available for our membership, as well as try to build awareness around what can be done within your facility. And we're always looking for new discussion opportunities, and we'll run custom programs if need be that help you identify either new novel technology that hasn't seen market share or other activities or processes that you're looking to implement. And we've done some of that here in and around this area, which have been fairly exciting. When we look at the overall costs of our energy efficiency programs, this represents kind of the cost curve in our MISO market. And you'll see that those highest costs occur in the summer months. And you know, if we can target any of our efficiency programs at where are we gonna get the most value, those are the periods of time that we're gonna get that. Our average rebate cost per kilowatt hour saved for egg programs was right around 5.26 cents, which is a really good deal when you think about the fact that those investments are gonna be in place for a number of years going forward. In addition, when we look at where our new assets are going to come from, GRE is fairly long on capacity, and we don't have a need to build new generation assets in the near future. We are going to be building additional transmission assets and trying to build our infrastructure, the energy delivery system, to really accommodate the new wave of generation resources. And really all we see going out in the future is wind. We're gonna be we have plans to enter into about 900 megawatts of additional wind capacity over the next 15 years. Those are all power purchase agreements with other producers. GRE doesn't actually own wind. And this is gonna be on top of at least 1,500 megawatts from that Xcel is going to be adding, 2,000 megawatts of wind that is going to be added by other utilities in Iowa, and we're going to see this trend continuing, and that's going to have an impact on our pricing in both the wholesale market and how we might be able to match that generation resource to our load, and that's going to be our focus going forward, is how do we match up renewables with end use consumption. With that, I thank you, and I think Mike.